Last year, I made a video expressing my concern around some libertarians only using the non-aggression principle when talking to people about libertarianism. I mentioned I didn't subscribe to the NAP myself, and just assumed for the sake of the video that it was a good ethical axiom. Some people asked me to make a more straightforward piece about the non-aggression principle, rather than linking to a whole podcast where only a portion was dedicated to addressing the NAP. Now, I want to divide this into multiple parts because I have many problems with it, and I can't address all of the arguments for it, since this video would be an epic. But I'm going to go over many of the main proposals, but there will be three main parts to this video. The reasoning and philosophical issues with the non-aggression principle, the impossibility of the non-aggression principle applied, and what I think is the most important argument against the non-aggression principle. Now, before we dive in, I still think the non-aggression principle has some value as a rule of thumb. The way most libertarians conceptualize the NAP is a good one, even if that conceptualization is incorrect. It's a shitty thing to initiate force on people, and I think it's really good as a starting point to consider law in a polycentric legal order. You'll get on very well if you look at it from this aspect. However, as an axiom for law or ethics, it would just be impossible to function and would prohibit most peaceful and nonviolent activity, and would make a libertarian social order impossible to construct. Being a libertarian myself, this is very counterproductive. Number 1, the philosophy of the NAP. The basic NAP. First, let's use the basic and most popular version we see in libertarian circles. From the Mises Wikipedia, libertarians typically claim that the non-aggression principle includes property and freedom of contracts as a part of self-ownership. The basis for this extension of self-ownership to one's property is John Locke's argument, also called the homesteading principle, that mixing of labor with an unowned resource makes that resource part of oneself. Subsequent exchange of property, e.g. sale and rental, simply transfers this right. Hence, to aggress against someone's property is to aggress against the individual. As for freedom of contract, the right of self-ownership is held to imply freedom of action in the absence of aggression, e.g. in the absence of false or duress contracts and the absence of contracts stipulating aggression against third parties. Let's set aside the ambiguity of the term self and just address what they mean, which is body ownership. There is a gap in this logic. Ethics is pretty distinct from other branches of philosophy because you can derive all kinds of prescriptive claims from descriptive claims. For instance, I could say that with just as much reasoning that there are people starving, therefore you should feed them. If people are starving, then people should be forced into programs that would eliminate starving, like welfare or socialist economic policies. This is what's known as Hume's Law, that is that you can't derive an ought statement from an is statement in ethics, or virtually any action could be justified or advocated for. Now, that's not to say that the is-ought gap isn't bridgeable, but you actually have to try to bridge it. Oh, but isn't saying that you can't get an ought from an is getting an ought from an is? No, for two very good reasons. One, it is not an ought statement. No one is saying that you ought not get an ought from an is, but that it is incorrect to assume an ought from an is. Two, even if it was saying that you ought not get an ought from an is, no one is saying that it is immoral to get an ought from an is, because the is-ought gap is a dilemma for normative claims, not positive statements. So you could say, if you want to make an omelet, you ought to use eggs, because that's a positive statement, versus you ought not make omelets because the way we get eggs is harmful to chickens. Now let's get into some of the branches of this particular version. One, natural law. Before he became an adherent of Hobbes' argumentation ethics, he was basing the NAP on natural law, which states that there exists an absolute and external standard of value, and the pattern of nature can determine right from wrong. That because humans act in certain ways, avoid death, reproduce, labor, that impending or taking these things is immoral. Again, this still falls prey to the is-ought gap. Just because humans don't want to die, get stolen from, or have their stuff taken, doesn't mean that you ought not act in such a fashion. Number 2, argumentation ethics. Hans Hermann Hoppe conceived of argumentation ethics to try to give some logical proof to the non-aggression principle while not relying on gods and governments as a basis, and to not smuggle in any other propositions other than praxeology. The argument goes like this: one cannot deny the law of contradiction without presupposing its validity. But there is another such proposition. Propositions are not free-floating entities. They require a proposition maker, who, in order to produce any validity-claiming proposition whatsoever, must have exclusive control, property, over some scarce means defined in objective terms and appropriate, brought under control, at definite points in time through homesteading action. Thus, any proposition that would dispute the validity of the homesteading principle of property acquisition, or that would assert the validity of a different, incompatible principle, would be falsified by the act of proposition making in the same way as the proposition, the law of contradiction, is false, would be contradicted by the very fact of asserting it. To summarize, to make the verbal statement, "I cannot speak," would be a performative contradiction. That is, in virtue of me saying those words, the opposite must be true. Me speaking is proof that the statement, "I cannot speak," is false. Because you own your own body, to make the claim, "I do not own myself," would be a contradiction, because you are using your body in accordance with self-ownership to make the claim that you do not own it. That is a performative contradiction. Therefore, to peacefully argue in respect of each other's property rights against this libertarian ethic, you are therefore engaged in a performative contradiction, because you are not engaged in some kind of physical conflict instead. In Bob Murphy and Gene Callahan's article, Hans Hermann Hoppe's Argumentation Ethic, a Critique, they rightly point out many errors. For instance, if I claim that the state should be funded by a currency made of people's amputated left leg, and that they should steal that leg from you, it wouldn't violate this ethic, as your leg is not needed to argue for property rights, as you only need your mouth, ears, eyes, heart, brain, and any other bodily parts essential for engaging in debate. But you can be wheeled in on a wheelchair to the debate, like Stephen Hawking, who can't use his legs, vocal cords, or hands at all, but still can provide propositional discourse of the highest caliber. Or if I tried to argue that no one should be allowed to have two kidneys, and that we should take one from everyone to make sure that people have at least one, since you don't need two kidneys to argue. Only one will suffice. Secondly, all of this only proves that the person is only interested in engaging in a peaceful debate in this particular instance, under these particular circumstances, and at this particular time, but not in any others. Sure, I could think that convincing you by slaughtering half of all living life might be the most effective in a rational discourse with you. But it may be more convincing to someone like Tony Stark by repeatedly punching him in the face. Or that perhaps punching you in the face isn't very compelling. Think about when you were younger and how older kids at school might have tried to get you to agree with something absurd by bullying you. Were you truly convinced by that wedgie? Did that noogie really get you to agree that Doug was a stupid show? Did that knuckle sandwich convince you that your milk money was in better hands with them? I did not think so. Trudil Tom also pointed out in his video that someone would be willing to use violence in almost every other aspect of his life, but chooses not to with you because he understands the cost of conflict might be too great, having to pay for your medical bills, legal fees, restitution, and harm that could be inflicted upon him in the process. Now, for me, I think there's some problems with the supposed performative contradictions people say are performative contradictions. Sure, by me speaking the words, "I cannot speak," is a good example. But you can imagine a universe where people do not own themselves, but are the sole dominion of a deity who can make the person think and say such sentences as, "I do not own myself." Or, how about a robot that you own? Such a robot can say something to the effect of, "I do not own myself." Such a proposition cannot be offered as logical proof, since the mere, even bizarre possibility that it can be true shows that it isn't proof that it's false. So, A for effort, Hoppe, but no dice. Number 2, property rights from first principles. This one is more common in YouTube libertarian circles. I'm going to be using a Shane Killian video to explain the logical construction of the non-aggression principle, not because I'm picking on him, but because he is the least cringy. Yeah, I know.
The first principle we'll look at is the foundational principle of all logic and reason, the principle of non-contradiction. Something cannot be A and not A at the same time. Also, if something is A, then it cannot be B if A and B are mutually exclusive. It may be possible for something that is A to later turn into B, but once it does, it cannot be A anymore.
That's correct.
Directly from this, we get the consistency principle. In logic, Consistency means that you don't contain any contradictions. So long as the principle of non-contradiction holds, the consistency principle does as well. While there are proofs of consistency, for purposes of this video, we'll just look at falsifiability. If we can find inconsistency in a posit, then the posit must be rejected. So if A and B are mutually exclusive and a true dichotomy, then falsifying A is all that you have to do to support B, and vice versa.
Well, that is correct, but his example is poor, so I omitted it just to alleviate confusion.
It's the consistency principle that leads us to establish burden of proof. The burden of proof is on the active side, not the passive side. There are a lot of things you're not doing right now. Maybe you're not collecting stamps at the moment. You're not walking on the moon. You're not inventing the hoverboard. You're not annexing the Sudetenland. There's an infinity of things you're not doing at the time. Imagine if someone said you had to justify every single one of them. There's no way you could do it. It would be inconsistent for someone to insist that you had to justify one or some of the things you're not doing, since you can't possibly justify them all. The only principle consistent with the consistency principle is that if you're not doing something, you don't have to justify it to anybody. The burden of proof is never on the passive side. Which means that the burden of proof must be on the active side when the active side conflicts with a passive side.
This is where it gets dicey. The examples given are pretty lopsided for his view on this principle, but then again, it is his video. For starters, sure, you don't have to justify not collecting stamps or walking on the moon. However, I think Shane and most libertarians would have ethical objections for not caring for your young offspring, who are in your custody. Not convincing your suicidal friend not to squeeze the trigger. Not defending your friend from bogus charges. In Shane's case in particular, not vaccinating your kids. By the way, people, please, vaccinate your fucking kids. There's lots of ethical issues with the passive and active sides of actions. By the way, there's lots of things that you would do that would be unreasonable to justify. Imagine having to justify breathing, eating, walking, talking, using a computer, every input you feed into it, every cough, every clearing of the throat, every sip of your Monster. By the way, Doom was a great game. One could make a reasonable case that it would be impossible to justify them all, as you would do more of these actions in the process of justifying them than you could justify them. Also, this leeches into the not being able to prove a negative canard, which is false. For example, I can indeed prove beyond a reasonable doubt that I never raped Helen Keller. Why? Because we never lived at the same time. I can also prove that the Loch Ness Monster can't exist by proving that the size of the lake can't produce enough food for such a large creature, and by pointing out that radar scans show no creature at the bottom of the water.
Now, going from nothing more than these first principles, let's see how this works in the libertarian status debate. Force is active. Ergo, those who want to use force have the burden of proof. Those who do not have no such burden at all. There really is no way around this. If someone's just sitting there not doing anything, the burden is on you to justify any action taken against him. Like, say, taking some of his money. And you can't worm your way out of this just by calling yourself a government. That is a blatant violation of the consistency principle. You can't have different rules for government than you do for the rest of us.
Again, there's passive and active sides to behaviors that probably need justification or probably should not.
So I know you statists are now chomping at the bit, getting your arguments all ready to justify the forceful actions your government does, but hold on, because initiation of force cannot be defended. Person A hires person B at $7 an hour. Person C, thinking person B should be paid at least $10 an hour, wants to point a gun at person A and make him pay person B more money. Is he justified in this? Think about it. What if person A then wants to point a gun back at person C because he doesn't want to be forced to do something he doesn't want to do? What's person C going to do? Say that person A doesn't get to use force, even though person C is doing what he's doing through force? How does person C have any legitimacy here at that point?
Here's a good counterexample. I'm walking down the street and I see someone muttering to themselves, "I can't take it anymore. I just want to end it all." A bus is speeding along and I see this person about to make the leap in front of the speeding bus. Are you saying that by me tackling this person can't be justified? What if they weren't proclaiming suicidal threats and were distracted by their cell phone? Is that too unjustifiable? What about someone restraining someone about to do something stupid that could kill them? Would Shane say that it was unjustifiable to forcibly prevent his kid from wanting to play with an alligator? I hope not.
Property rights is the logical structure we use to determine who is initiating force and when. This isn't a pragmatic idea. It, too, is based on first principles. We start with the principle of self-ownership. Basically, you own yourself. You own your body, your mind, your time, and the fruits of your labors. Why? Well, what would it mean if you didn't? Who else would own you? If someone else can own you, that would make you their slave. But slavery completely violates the consistency principle. Who gets to own slaves? And who is subject to being enslaved? You would be making different rules for different people, which you don't get to do.
I agree. But 3, 4, and 5 are insufficient in supporting this.
So self-ownership is the only consistent way, and that naturally leads to private property.
Again, I agree, but 3, 4, and 5 are insufficient in supporting this claim.
So from nothing more than a logical examination of first principles, we come to the following inescapable conclusion. Taking of legitimately owned property cannot be defended. Owning property is passive. Taking that property is active. At the very least, as we discussed earlier, the burden of proof is on the side of the property taker.
Now, this is just a rehashed version of number 5, but I might as well try again. I, nor most people, nor you, hopefully would be okay with not intervening if they saw a loved one putting a gun they owned in their mouth and threatening to pull the trigger. Oh, I'm sorry. I meant squeeze the trigger. I hear that's only okay if you say it. Or if your child wraps his jump rope around his neck and ties the other side to the top of a door. And because there's problems with number 3 and number 4, this can't follow. Number 3, universally preferable behavior. Now, I could do a whole video on Stefan Molyneux's universally preferable behavior and how bad it is, and I almost did in a live stream. But I'm not going to explain you what UPB is here because it is too dense and too nonsensical, and the subject would overrun my entire video. So if you're familiar with this, this may be useful to understanding its flaws. If you don't understand it, then you'll be armed with enough information to go into universally preferable behavior to know where the flaws are. Either way, I'll keep this very brief. The problem with UPB lies in the idea that people who do go into a debate are interested in the facts and seeking truth, and not just trying to win points with peers, try to defend ideas based on faith and not evidence, and to defend one's ego, Molyneux, or to spread false information to achieve some kind of goal. Kind of like how accelerationists will argue that universal basic income is a sound economic policy to people knowing that it will bring upon a governmental collapse. He also points out that just you living is proof of universally preferable behavior, because in order for you to be here to begin with, you would have had to have breathed, ate food, drank liquids, etc. in order to live. Unfortunately, this is all true for people who have extreme suicidal ideations. People don't necessarily do these things because they want to survive, but do them because they don't want to deal with the uncomfortable or painful experience of being deprived of these things, like starvation and dehydration. He also falsely claims that breathing is a choice, when in reality, that breathing is both an involuntary and voluntary option. Which is why you don't hear about people killing themselves by holding their breath. They asphyxiate themselves by other means, because after a while, your medulla oblongata kicks in and forces you to inhale. Also, asphyxiating yourself would be an action, not an inaction, thus rendering his whole point moot. Also, one can make the claim with empirical data, the reason any of us are here, because somewhere down your line, someone was raped to give birth to one of your ancestors. Lots of times in your lineage, in fact. Do we now say that rape is now moral because your existence is predicated on rape? Of course not. Part 2. Consequentialist problems with the non-aggression principle. 1. Infeasibility. Now, when I say that the NAP is impossible for anyone to follow or to have a legal standard implemented, this doesn't mean that it's impossible to enforce it 100% or to follow it 100%. That's not what that means. What I mean is that you can't implement such a legal order, nor live in a world that prohibits it. In his book, The Machinery of Freedom, which I recommend to anybody interested in libertarianism to read, David writes a chapter about the consequentialist problems with the NAP in a chapter called Problems. Imagine a revolver pistol with six chambers, and only in one of those chambers houses a round. You spin the cylinder and press the gun against someone's temple and pull the trigger. Squeeze a trigger. Whether or not a round discharges, all libertarians would agree that this is a violation of the non-aggression principle, and it would be a violation if it was a 1 in 6 chance of discharging or a 1 in trillion chance, though that would be a pretty big fucking pistol. So how is it that we allow people to drive cars when even driving carefully could result in the injury or death of pedestrians and other motorists? Not even being at fault, fainting at the wheel, mechanical or computer failures, getting startled, whatever. And the odds of that happening are far more likely than 1 in a trillion. Ah, but intent matters. You're not trying to hurt anyone by driving, but you were intending to hurt someone with that gun. No. First intent doesn't matter. If I decide to dance on the wall of my third floor balcony and knock over one of my planters on accident and smash your car's windshield, does that not mean I'm not responsible for my actions because my intent wasn't to cause harm? Secondly, you don't know what my motivation for doing that with a gun. If my intent was to cause harm, don't you think it would have been counterintuitive to only load the chamber with only one bullet, or at least make sure that the next chamber would have had that bullet, or that I shouldn't have spinned the chamber or pulled the trigger more than just once? What if I was mentally ill and thought that if I did that, it would not kill you, but bring about Ancapistan into existence? And soon we're going to live in a world where self-driving cars will be near perfected. Are we to ban manual driving cars? The other problem David points out is this. Say that I have a death laser, and this laser can shoot photons at such a powerful degree that it can burn a house down in 1 second flat. Would it be okay for me to shoot it at your house? No? Well, what if I dialed it down to it only took 10 minutes to burn down your house? Would that be okay? No? What about less than that, and it took 10 hours? What about if it took 10 days? 10 years? What if it was strong enough to only beam the same amount of light photons as a candle and couldn't cause any physical damage whatsoever to your house, even in a million years? Oh, that's okay? Well, congratulations, you reject the non-aggression principle on consequentialist grounds. Because you are no longer interested in the moral prohibitions on the violations of property, you only reject them if the consequences are damaging. Why should it stop at photons? Is the violation of property rights the same if I burn 1,000 tires in my backyard covering your house in soot and smoke, or just a little bit of smoke and soot from my cigar as it wafts into your property from my front porch? Again, consequences don't matter, and I ought not smoke if that smoke would enter your property without your predetermined expressed agreement. In fact, breathing would be a violation of everyone's non-aggression principle, as CO2 is a pollutant that no one agreed it was okay for me to release these gases, even if the effects were negligible at worst. Having lights visible from your property, driving cars, even breathing would be immoral in a purely deontological non-aggression principle ethical framework, and the amount of legal wrangling to allow all of these actions legally would make it impossible. 2. It doesn't prohibit shitty things most libertarians would find objectionable. Not all libertarians think the NAP is the only thing to consider when looking at morality and the ethics of actions. The ones who don't? Good on you. There's lots of shitty things that people do that aren't violations of the non-aggression principle. Remember when that really creepy dude was doxing Stefan Molyneux's fans and Molyneux used that to not only file a bogus DMCA claim against him, but also a critic who wasn't doxing anyone at all? Why did he do that? The reason I ask is because doxing people is not a violation of the non-aggression principle. I did a video about this years ago, and I'll link that in the description. Posting information is not a violation, just like sharing ideas is not a violation, unless that information is being shared, is also attached with a message calling for actions, like, here's where the guy lives, go and kill him. It's not even the information that's being shared that's the problem. It's the cult of violence that is the problem and would violate the NAP with or without the dox included. You also don't own the numbers and letters that make up your identifiable information. Also, there's examples where doxing people is a good thing, like doxing someone who's committing some kind of crime with victims to agencies who can stop them from doing those actions. How about revenge porn? Remember all those dick pics you sent your lady friend who's now mad at you and she's going around sharing your private sexy pics online to shame you? Guess what? Ain't nothing wrong with that under the non-aggression principle. You gave those photos out to people, they can do with them as they please, unless, you know, you believe in copyright. How about exposing yourself to children? How about letting your kids starve to death? How about not telling your mom you love her when you do? Not pointing any fingers, Vault. Part 3. The most important argument. It's a spook. No, really, that's it. Next slide. Oh, put the next slide up. Fine, I'll expound. Things like religion, moral rules, political concepts, and even economic theories don't exist in the real world, even when they are practiced. They are phantasms of the mind, a spook, if you will. That doesn't necessarily mean that they're bad for people to do, quite the contrary. In many cases, property norms have a measurable benefit to society, but they don't exist out of people's minds who accept them. If you get on best living with or associating with people who do hold to these ideas, great, go do that. But to claim that these moral systems exist anywhere outside of your head is silly. And as I've shown earlier, the NAP is very flawed, and that no libertarian would support it if they understood what it allowed for and what it prohibits. Okay, Jim, then what's your solution? Well, I'm glad you asked. Consider consequences. Again, David's book is a great primer on why a stateless libertarian social order would be optimal without all these bizarre and infeasible ethical spooks that just make you sound like an autistic person when you try to bring them up. Sure, it's a shitty thing to levy taxes or take and damage people's stuff, kill people, boss people around, have central banks, ban fun things, bomb people, toss flashbangs in babies' cribs, and all kinds of stuff like that. But these philosophical parlor tricks don't even hold up against scrutiny from some libertarian podcaster and Twitter shitposter. This should give you pause. Anyways, I will talk to you guys later. Worms.